Just outside San Francisco, Pixar Studios, the team behind the original Toy Story, have come up with the unthinkable. Well, at least as far as animated feature films are concerned, a sequel, Toy Story 2. But the challenge this time is, will they be able to make a film even better than the first?
To infinity and beyond!
Our cameras have been given exclusive behind-the-scenes access to show you the making of Toy Story 2.
Honestly, other than the fact that the characters are identified, it's got nothing to do with the first one.
Right, of course.
It's a completely different, independent, unique, original movie all on its own, which does not require you to have seen anything other than the first few minutes of Toy Story 2.
It's showtime! All right!
It's a month later in the house, Andy's house. Month later in Andy's life, month later in that little bedroom. Month later in those toys' lives. And we get to dive in a little bit deeper.
He's stealing Woody.
What? Somebody do something!
Woody was kidnapped.
Woody once risked his life to save me. I couldn't call myself his friend if I weren't willing to do the same. So who's with me?
Pixar Studios, just outside San Francisco, is home to some of the world's finest animators and technicians.
Good afternoon, Pixar.
For the past 3 years, a production crew of 250, whose average age is only 26, have been working around the clock developing and creating Toy Story 2. It's the kind of place where you can bring your dog to work, take your parrot to the office, and if you're working late, there's always somewhere to sleep.
What time is it anyway?
Although these animators use state-of-the-art computers, the starting point is still good old-fashioned pen and paper, plus a cracking storyline.
The story that we start off with is basically the same thing that we said 3 years ago. It was Woody was stolen by a toy collector and has to make the decision of, is it better to be loved by a child or to live forever as a collectible?
Yeah.
That theme has stayed since the beginning of the film.
Yeah.
Everything else has changed.
Sequels are notoriously difficult to crack because the public's expectations are so high. As the plot has evolved, over 29,000 hand-drawn storyboards have been produced, plotting out each scene frame by frame. The test for the story editors, Dan and Joe, however, is to see if the scene works when acted out to a select group of colleagues and me.
He's just totally freaked out by the dream, so he wakes up and he's like completely freaked out. Looks around the room and he's in Andy's room, everything's okay. He swings his arm around from behind his back and he smacks him in the face and he knocks into these books and it kicks up all his dust. He starts coughing and then he hears something off screen. He sees this little puff of dust coming out and he doesn't know what it is, so he pulls away this book and he's having a hard time with it because his arm's damaged. And he pulls away and he reveals this little squeezed toy penguin. And he says, Wheezy, is that you?
Hey, Woody.
What are you doing up here? I thought Mom took you to get your squeaker fixed months ago.
Nah, she just told him that to calm him down and then put me up here on the shelf.
Well, why didn't you yell for help?
Well, I tried squeaking, but I'm still broken. No one could hear me. Besides, the dust aggravates my condition.
Over. Woody catches him and he says,
what's the point in prolonging the inevitable? We're all just one stitch away from here to there.
And he points out the window and we zoom in on this. Outside the window, we see Mom putting a yard sale sign up and we cut back to Woody and he's completely panicked. He says, yard sale?
Joe, you actually play the part, don't you?
Yeah, I'm the part of
Wheezy
in the movie.
The
way Dan drew Wheezy was, I mean, to me, a big inspiration on how to play him as a voice.
Based on the story meetings we had, I pretty much interpreted it how I thought it should be, staging-wise, or what his attitudes and acting. And I think when you see it in the finished film, it influenced the animators.
Wheezy? Is that you?
Hey, Woody.
What are you doing up here? I thought Mom took you to get your squeaker fixed months ago. Andy was so upset.
Nah, she just told him that to calm him down and then put me on the shelf.
Well, why didn't you yell for help?
Well, I tried squeaking, but I'm still broken. No one could hear me. Besides, the dust aggravates my condition. What's the point in prolonging the inevitable? We're all just one stitch away from here to there.
Yard sale.
Yard sale! Yard sale!
Central to the success of Toy Story, though, is one man, director John Lasseter. John has won not one, but two Oscars. And his sense of fun extends to kitting his Oscars out in their very own designer outfits.
Look what it lifts, look what Oscar...
No, it has a little velvet bag, I couldn't find it this morning.
Okay, so it lifted the tea towel. Okay,
John's genius and inspiration have been with the company right from the beginning.
Now, originally, Pixar was a computer company. Right. We had developed the Pixar Image Computer. And then we went from hardware to software. Yeah. But all that time, there was a small group, about six of us, that were doing computer animation research. We did a bunch of short films. And I saw the potential of this medium. I was excited about the ability to create a true three-dimensional environment. Everything in this environment seemed solid, dimensional, real. And it's funny how at that point in time, you know, people just saw that, oh, it was expensive and it was, you know, but can it really do, you know, characters and can it do realistic backgrounds? And I knew it would someday. Our dream all along was someday to do a feature film with this technology. And finally, in about 1991, we made a deal with Disney to do our first movie, which turned out to be Toy Story, and that was released in 1995.
Hey, who moved my doodle pad way over here?
How you doing, Rex?
Were you scared? Tell me honestly.
I was close to being scared that time.
Oh, I'm going for fearsome here, but I just don't feel it. I think I'm just coming off as annoying.
Ow! Oh, hi, Bo. Hi.
I wanted to thank you, Woody, for saving my flock.
Oh, hey, it was, nothing.
What do you say I get someone else to watch the sheep tonight?
Hell yeah.
Remember, I'm just a couple of blocks away.
When we were kind of thinking of what would be our first feature film, we thought, well, you know, what can we do? And I always thought toys were like perfect subject matter because they're man-made objects.
Buzz! Oh, Buzz! Buzz Lightyear! Buzz Lightyear, thank goodness! We've got trouble!
Trouble? Where?
Down there! Just down there! A helpless toy! He's trapped, Buzz!
Then we've no time to lose!
The other cool thing about choosing toys as subject matter is I got to go to a toy store during work hours, buy toys with a company credit card, and call it research.
Of course.
I had died and gone to heaven then.
I don't see anything!
He's there! Just keep looking!
I'm trying to talk!
Soon after we finished Toy Story, I always felt that there was so much more you could do with the subject matter of toys being alive. And I just actually thought about this office, right? You know, and I have five sons. And when my little boys come to visit me, they love to come to Daddy's work, right? Well, they come in here and they immediately just go, and they look around and start playing with all, they want to play with all these toys. And, yeah. And there's a lot of collectible toys in here. Things that I've collected, one-of-a-kind toys and all this stuff. And, of course, they want to play with them.
Yeah.
So out of that notion grew this idea. And then we thought, well, Woody could get caught up with the notion of being a collectible, you know. And then, you know, forget the notion of really what the purpose of being a toy is. And that is to make a child happy. And he has to relearn and Buzz, which is great. Buzz, who learned about being a toy in the first movie, yeah. Has to teach Woody...
There's a great moment where Woody tells Buzz, because you're a toy.
You are a toy.
Exactly.
Right.
You are a toy! You weren't the real Buzz Lightyear. You're an action figure. You are a child's plaything.
You are a sad, strange little man, and you have my pity.
That is really the pivotal moment in Toy Story 2, and we wanted to have that wonderful, you know, reversal, to have Buzz say to Woody this time, yeah. You are a toy. You're not a collectible. You're a child's plaything.
I can't go. I can't abandon these guys. They need me to get into this museum. And without me, they'll go back into storage, maybe forever.
Woody, you're not a collector's item. You're a child's plaything. You are a toy!
For how much longer? One more rip, and Andy's done with me. And what do I do then, Buzz, huh? You tell me!
The second time around doing this was more difficult than the first time because it's not as innocent. I have to really develop the character, and it was a long time between, what, 95?
Was that when it came out? Oh, Landy. It's a long time ago. This time, we had to go back and re-mine it, you know, right. In order to find it, but at the same time, make it different enough so that it would stand up to be worthy of being, you know, a Woody.
So that
Buzz.
You all enjoy it.
Cowboy Crunchies, the only cereal that's sugar frosted and dipped in chocolate, proudly presents Woody's
Roundup. In Toy Story 2, you find out that Woody is from an old 50s TV show called Woody's Roundup. Now, there's three characters from that who were in that TV show with him, and you meet them. First, you meet Woody's horse, Bullseye.
Where's my trusty steed, Bullseye? I have to ride off into the sunset!
And then you get to meet Mrs. Potato Head.
Oh, my little sweet potato!
Oh, you found it! Oh, it's so nice to have a big, strong spud around the house.
And then there's Jessie, the cowgirl, and she's a real tough cowgirl. I mean, she's great.
Sweet mother of Abraham Lincoln, the prospector, he'll want to meet ya!
And then you have Stinky Pete the prospector, and he's kind of the comic sidekick on the TV show. But what's special about him is that he is mint in the box.
Say hello to the prospector!
It's a box.
He's mint in the box. Never been opened.
Turn me around, Bullseye, so I can see. Why, the prodigal son has returned.
What kind of life would that be? Right, not very fun, but that's what the Stinky Pete the prospector.
Yeah,
and he plays most of the show.
In his box.
In his box. Yeah, it's very funny. You meet Buzz Lightyear's archenemy, Zurg.
So, we meet again, Buzz Lightyear, for the last time.
It's Zurg!
You get to meet the owner of Al's Toy Barn.
Okay.
Al, he is the collector who ends up stealing Woody. Yeah.
I found him!
Buster! Quiet down! Excuse me, can I help you?
So, how about the voices? Any new fantastic voices?
Jessie the cowgirl is voiced by Joan Cusack.
Yep.
It's amazing. It is truly amazing. It's just a shocking thing to be part of, to see all these beautiful, talented things come all together.
Stinky Pete the prospector is Kelsey Grammer, Frasier.
Okay, Frasier.
He's great. He's great.
They told me I would be playing the prospector. I learned in subsequent conversations that I was going to be also called Stinky Pete.
Stinky Pete.
You never know when you take on one of these handles, it might destroy your career forever.
We don't hire voices for how big of a star they are. We hire voices for how good of an actor they are and how their voice fits.
It could just be any voice. So somebody off the street could be a voice.
There's a little one-line part in Toy Story we haven't voiced yet.
It's not.
You want to do it?
Don't say that.
No.
Are you joking?
No, I'm not joking.
No.
I am not joking. Would you like to do a voice in Toy Story 2?
I'd love it.
Seriously?
Would you like to? I would love it.
It's one line.
One line.
Yeah.
Seriously?
Yeah, absolutely. In the real movie. We'll put it in the real movie.
For sure.
Yeah, absolutely.
Toy Story 2, starring Tom Hanks, Tim Allen, Andy Peters.
Tell
Tom is a super active kid. I can't keep up with him. So getting Jerry, it seemed like a good idea at the time. They're always chasing each other, you know, just like in the cartoon. Tom follows Jerry to all the filthiest places. Disgusting. I can't keep them apart.
New Aerial Hygiene with its caring antibacterial action cleans and protects against germs, even in a 40-degree wash.
You know, sometimes it's hard to tell where the boy ends and the dog begins.
Oh, go on then, as it's Christmas.
Don't miss Boxing Day at DFS. More choice, more savings. With double the sale discount on many items. Double your savings on this leather sofa, just $485. Double your savings on this stylish three-seater sofa, only $399.
And that's not all. DFS gives you 3 years free credit. And there's nothing to pay for a whole year.
Double discount means double savings on Boxing Day in the DFS sale.
We'll never really know how people celebrated the last millennium. This time, we will.
Then the trucks came over the hill.
Every week over Christmas, Summerfield have over 40 buy one, get one free offers. It's like buying one trolley full and getting exactly the same trolley full free.
Space, we've been there. Time, that's the new frontier. Physically traveling through time isn't possible. But with a time machine from Time Computers, you can go into the future. Imagine a whole book, encyclopedia, or even a movie on a single disc. And the internet is changing the way the next generation think. From here, we can see a billion years into the past. With a time machine, you can see into the future.
A line in Toy Story 2, can you believe it? After a sleepless night, I thought I'd try out some vocal exercises before my big recording moment. How now, brown cow? How... John, hello.
Hey.
I've just done a bit of practising.
Have you?
Yeah.
Are you excited?
You just don't know how excited I am. You really don't.
You are baggage handler number one. That's
okay.
Your character.
As long as I'm a...
Big character. Okay?
Yeah.
You're on screen.
Yep.
Excellent. Okay. So your line is going to be, hold it, there's an, and you're yelling.
Okay.
It's, you know, imagine the sound of like Heathrow Airport,
yeah.
You're down on the tarmac and
yeah,
all these planes around and stuff
yeah.
like that. So it's pretty loud. So you're yelling, hold it, there's a couple more bags coming from the terminal.
Okay.
Okay, try it.
Okay. Hold it, there's a couple more bags coming from the terminal.
Yeah, a little louder.
Hold it, there's a couple more bags coming from the terminal. Because I'm English, I would say there's a couple of more bags. I mean, I'm sorry, I don't mean to change the script, but...
There's a couple of?
Yeah, there's a couple of more. There's a couple of... Oh, yeah.
A couple more bags.
It sounds so American.
More bags. It doesn't?
Yeah.
Well, you're living in America?
Oh, no,
I'm sorry, hi. For a second.
Okay.
I just have to get you to sign one thing before you go, and I just need to get a copy of your work permit.
Yeah, it's producer stuff.
Okay.
Producer stuff.
Okay. Do you have a copy of the work permit?
Work permit? What work permit?
For the U.S.
No. Sorry, no.
You don't have a work permit for the U.S.?
No, not for here.
You
okay,
don't
I was,
have a work permit
okay,
for the
I was
U.S.?
Told...
No, don't. Oh, my goodness.
All right, well...
This
was
for real. This was no joke. Apparently, I didn't have the right permit to work as a film voice talent in the States.
You're not allowed to work in the United States unless you have a work permit for the
It looked like my starring role was about to be axed. Does that mean I won't be in the film, though?
So, you mean he can't do it?
No, he can't do it.
He can't do it?
No.
But so, here's the idea. Would you be willing, when you go back to London, to go into a recording studio in London and record it there? See, I could still direct you from Pixar. Because what I do this a lot with different actors, is that I am do it with teleconferencing.
Right.
So we have a little teleconferencing, and there's a camera shooting at me, and a camera shooting at you.
From New York.
And you can hear me, I can hear you.
Right, and I just do the line from London.
And you do the line from London, I'll direct you.
And it'll be great.
And you'll be in the movie.
And I'll still
You'll be in the movie, and that's the way we can get around
this. They're having a laugh at me. Are you sure? Yeah.
That's the way we can get around the work permit thing.
Yeah.
Marvellous. It looks like I'm still going to be in the film. Right. This is the animation pit where 60 animators are working on individual frames of the film. Their workstations are a million miles from your regular office, and the way they work is as unconventional as the films they produce. The animators are positively encouraged to express their individuality and creativity at work. So you might find Mark, who works in a tiki hut, and Rich, well, he's created a jungle for himself.
We find one thing that really helps the energy of the film is to, you know, you're walking out to lunch and you're looking at someone's little cubicle thing and like you see their shot playing, oh, and you start talking about their shot and you're talking about your shot.
And why did it get the nickname the pit then?
The pit or the barnyard, take your pick. But it's like a big frat house, you know. I mean, a lot of these guys came here right out of school, you know, so this is really just like a big filthy dorm room.
They're finally on top.
Dr. Stash, what's the matter?
Dude.
As the person in charge of making sure all the animators are doing what they should be doing, what for you makes any one animator better than another?
It's just like casting a play.
You
know, you've got like the, you know, you've got all these different characters, and then you have all these different actors to choose from.
Gosh.
And you're really just saying, well, here's the nutty professor. Well, we'll definitely give that to Doug.
Nice.
And then
there's
the quiet, introspective waif. Well, we'll give that to Tasha.
Time to get up?
Oh, Tasha, tell me, help me. When's my shot due? Oh, just a dream.
The only thing I have to worry about is how the animation looks. You know, is the performance feel natural? Does it feel like the character's really alive? You don't want someone to look at it and go, wow, that's great animation. You want someone to go, boy, that was a really powerful scene, or that was a really entertaining movie, or boy, that scared me, or man, I almost cried. I mean, that's what we want, something that feels really natural.
Every day, Glenn's joined by Ash, who's one of the co-directors of the film, and they do the animation walkthrough. It's at this time they're checking and rechecking every one of the 24 frames that make up 1 second of filmed material. It's Glenn and Ash's responsibility to approve each animator's shot before John Lasseter gives them the final green light.
Nothing's flashing in here, right?
No, they're just on bright all the time.
Angus is one of the youngest animators who came here straight from college. This shot of Buzz is technically difficult and forms part of the opening sequence of the film.
Oh, so when it stops? Or, no, right
there.
There.
Do you want to ease out on how their rotations slow? They're rotating pretty fast and then, like, boom. You know, like, have that go over a couple more frames?
Mm-hmm. You want more frames on that?
Yeah.
Yeah, just so they slow down slower.
You study the object and find these things that make it definitive to that object. By nature, the computer likes to create images and objects that are absolutely perfect.
Yeah.
Every corner is sharp. Everything is perfectly clean. Everything would look like plastic, you know. But our world is not like that. Yeah. And if you create a world that's completely sterile like that, people will find it cold. People won't find it believable.
Okay, here's our chance. Ready, set, go! Drop! Go! Drop! I said drop! Drop! Go!
Mm-hmm.
unlike other animation studios, animators here are not assigned to just one character. At any given time, literally dozens of animators can be working on scenes with Woody or Buzz, injecting their very own individual personalities into each shot.
So an animator's job here at Pixar is to bring our characters to life. When we get the characters, they're in the layout form where they're just moving around like on escalators, and we have the dialogue from people like Tom Hanks, Tim Allen, and it's up to us to read that dialogue, understand what the character's motivation is.
Would you say that you're an actor in a funny sort of way, because do you put yourself in his shoes and look
Absolutely.
At the way you're moving, the way you're functioning?
Absolutely, and that's one of the most interesting things is that you can, you know, five different people can animate Buzz, and you will actually see personality traits of the people who are animating them in the character. Mm-hmm. You know, you move your head a certain way and you'll interject that into the character.
Yeah.
And so this is the scene as I get it from layout.
Mission log. Have reached Zurg's command deck, but no sign of him or his wooden captive.
Have you already stood here going, mission log?
Yes.
You're right, okay.
I've spent probably a day doing all of that, thinking about things, thinking about where's his body coming from, where's it going to,
okay.
Where does it need to end up?
Mission log. Have reached Zurg's command deck, but no sign of him or his wooden captive.
With the help of a camera, Dylan acts out Buzz Lightyear's shot in the mirror room. This way, he can see how Buzz would look from every angle.
Mission log. Have reached Zurg's command deck, but no sign of him or his wooden captive.
After that, I'll spend another day or so. So this is probably 2 days later.
Mission log. Have reached Zurg's command deck, but no sign of him or his wooden captive.
So you can see this, the basics working. You can see the basic pose graphically that's worked out. Here's the final one. Like, this will have the lip sync in there.
Mission log. Have reached Zurg's command deck, but no sign of him or his wooden captive. Mission log. Have reached Zurg's command deck, but no sign of him or his wooden captive.
Dailies. What exactly are these things that you all call dailies?
There's things called dailies.
There's things called dailies.
Exactly.
What are they?
We get together with John in a big screening room for maybe 2.5 hours a day, usually at 8 a.m. It's an opportunity for the animators to show their shots to John and have John comment on them. But almost more importantly, it's a chance for all the other animators to see what everybody else is doing.
Okay! Angus!
Angus nervously awaits John's reaction.
So, we meet again, Buzz Lightyear.
So this is an old recording?
For the last time!
No, that's right. That's right. I think this is an old recording.
When the sphere goes away and they fall, they just go straight down, and when they hit, they drop, right?
Yeah.
Why is it? They still look like they
Yeah, it looks like they're not rotating around the edge that hits first.
I'm running into, if you want them to turn anymore, we're probably going to have to make the bubble bigger.
Maybe they need one more frame on the edge before they drop or something. Because I think actually it might be fun to have them like spinning as they fall, and when they get caught, their up and down translate would, you know, bounce like sort of a spring. But
John identifies further problems with the shot. So sadly for Angus, it hasn't passed.
Okay, next.
Yeah. This is Stephen Gregory trying to file Al 2137B.
Did you do all that yesterday?
Oh, yeah. No.
It needs a little something just to keep them going. Because I think if you put something small in, you'll really...
If John approves the shot, he waves his monkey laser pen at the screen and calls it a final.
So we're going to call it the final one. Dailies is a very important part of the production process because, to me, it's important for everybody to be seeing what everybody else is doing.
Exactly.
It's just, you know, it's a lot of fun.
I didn't get it either.
So what it is the dog needs to go to the bathroom.
It's like, oh, gee, oh, I gotta go. Oh,
faster,
yeah, a little faster. There it is. When you really have to go, what is it like? It's like, oh.
You gotta get the dance. It looks like
an
happy
TV dance.
That looks like Pee Wee Herman.
Have you got no rhythm? I don't have any rhythm.
Go, girl.
Now,
to do it on all fours.
Probably the biggest thing that drives everybody, that keeps everybody's enthusiasm up, is the passion of John. I mean, John is probably more excited than anybody about this movie.
He is the godfather of the whole thing. I must say that I never knew anything about Toy Story without knowing without John Lasseter being the guy who was there. He is the guy that somehow is able to keep the entire film in his head for each one of us over the course of the 3 years that it takes to make the movie. He can answer any question, and he guides us through every single one of the scenes.
It makes such a difference when we're giving out shots to animators, to have him get up and work with the animators. Okay, you know, in this shot, you know, Buzz is, you know, trying to convince Woody to come back with him, and, you know, John acts it out with the animators, and, you know, the animators get excited about the shot, and they run back, and they, you know, they block it out, they show it to John, he sees it, and he gets excited, and then they're excited that he's excited.
Doug, in this shot, this is when Woody has decided, you know, I'm going to the museum. We kind of want to play into the audience's expectation where they think he's going to be all macho and cowboy coming out of these, like, fake saloon doors. Bam! I'm the sheriff in town, you know, and all like that. But instead, it's like he comes out and he's just like not even looking at her.
Right.
That's like, really funny.
He like comes out and keeps his arms up. He like shoots his cuffs, and then kind of just does like he's kind of like vamping a little bit, like a little kind of like to the audience.
Right. Uh huh.
And then it's not until he like turns his head, and he sees her, and he's like, ooh. As he's delivering his line to her, he like does this thing where he's like kind of looking over his shoulder, anywhere like but her. So it's just like,
because that's cool.
Yeah, hey baby, take me in. Take in all this manliness I got for you.
Say that, hey, little missy. Yeah. See any trouble around these parts?
Any trouble around these parts?
Say, little missy, you notice any trouble around these parts?
Now at the end of the shot, right, he's going into this acting, and then he gets another idea. Right, he gets the idea where it's like, oh, and then we could do this, and then we do this, and then he runs out.
So he breaks character.
Yeah, he breaks character and just gets kind of like so excited and kind of manic, you know. So it was like, you know, so he could be.
Because he realizes this is his performance.
Like it's, I got it. Yeah. You know, like that. Okay. So it's like that quick change would be great.
Oh, wait, I got it. Oh, this is great. Okay. All right, the bandits got the critters tied up in the burning barn, and now, for the best part. Help us! Help!
The high-ridingest, rootin'-tootin'est cowboy hero of all time, Sheriff Woody!
Say, little missy, you notice any trouble around these parts?
Nary a bit! Not with Sheriff Woody around!
Wait, I got it! This is great! Okay, the bandits got the critters tied up in the burning barn, and now for the best part! Help us! The barn's on fire! I've got your critters. No need to worry. Woody saves the day again.
We always, at this time, we're talking about the acting. Mm. It's not the technical. It's not the computer quality. And we talk about the acting. But it's really important that the animator knows how their singular shot fits into the overall. Doug animated a shot in Toy Story. You remember that? It's like when Woody shoves him and it accidentally opens Buzz's helmet.
He's gasping.
And Doug did this great job of gasping on Buzz Lightyear. He had about three shots in a row.
Stop with this spaceman thing. It's getting on my nerves.
Are you saying you want to lodge a complaint with Star Command?
Oh, okay. Ooh, well, so you want to do it the hard way, huh?
Don't even think about it, cowboy.
Oh, yeah? Tough guy?
One day, he just put some like two pose blocking of Woody, just looking down, looking out, and looking kind of at the camera. Yeah. And because it was in between these two shots of Buzz, just like, you know, just, it was, the minimal acting just was hilarious. And we said, Doug, just smooth it out, and you're done.
Isn't toxic. How dare you open a spaceman's helmet on an uncharted planet? My eyeballs could have been sucked from their sockets.
I returned to England and waited for the phone call to summon me to the studio to record my line. So it's now some 2.5 weeks since I was in San Francisco, and as you know, I couldn't record the line there because, well, there was a lot of problems. But in my hand I have here a piece of paper, which is a legal document that now allows me to be a voice on Toy Story 2. Now, John.
Yes.
John is. Hi, and hello, Lee.
Hello.
Hello. Now, they are live in San Francisco. It's the middle of the night here, practically. And we're going to do this line. So, guys, this is the piece of paper. I'm just holding. There's a camera here, which I'm now holding this piece of paper. This is the contract. It's all signed.
Where's your signature?
Just there. Look, just there by the X. Just there.
Okay, all right. Okay, we can proceed now, Andy.
Absolutely. So, first and foremost, how's it going? Are you nearly all done?
Just about 3 more weeks left to do. We're starting our post-production, which you are a part of.
Thank you.
What is your character? Do you know your character?
I am baggage handler number one.
Or is it? Or number two?
Baggage handler number one.
Yeah, okay, we'll make it baggage handler one. You have to, when you do this line, you have to be kind of loud. You have to talk over the ambient noise that's okay. going to be around there. Okay?
Yeah.
We are going to slate the tape.
Okay, this is LGS 912, take number one.
Okay, now you're going to hear the line of dialogue.
Hold it! There's a couple more bags coming from the terminal!
Okay, Andy, go ahead.
Hold it! There's a couple more bags coming from the terminal!
Okay, again, we'll play it for you.
Okay.
Okay.
Do it like that.
I think we can all go home now.
Hold it! There's a couple more bags coming from the terminal.
It's just like, all right, go hold it. There's a couple more bags coming from the terminal.
Okay.
Like that. Yeah. Sort of like, oh, another delay kind of thing.
Sure.
Ready?
Yeah.
So listen to it again for the timing.
Okay.
Hold it! There's a couple more bags coming from the terminal.
Hold it! There's a couple more bags coming from the terminal.
Hold it! There's a couple more bags coming from the terminal.
Hold it! There's a couple more bags coming from the terminal.
That's good. Okay, we're covered on that line, Andy. Congratulations.
Thank
good.
You. So, guys, how did I do?
I think you did great. It was, you know, you sounded natural. You're loud enough to be heard over the jet engines.
Are we sure my name is going to be on the end?
Oh, yeah, it's in. We've given you a credit in additional voices.
How exciting is that? Take care. Bye-bye.
Okay. Bye-bye. We're going to sign off.
With less than 3 weeks to go to the Hollywood premiere, I flew to one of the last music sessions in Los Angeles to meet the film's composer, 12-time Oscar nominee, Randy Newman. He's the one in the blue.
So this is it, the nerve centre of the recording studio, where they're knocking out songs like they're going out of fashion.
Randy Newman has a wonderful and long relationship with Pixar. He worked on the original Toy Story. He worked on A Bug's Life as well. And when Randy Newman was originally chosen for Toy Story, it had to do with a lot of the different scores that he had done over time. He is just an amazing composer.
So when you finished watching the first Toy Story, Did you think, that's it, I'm going to do the second? Whether he asks me or not, I'll be...
Oh, I didn't know there'd be a second. I don't think anyone did. No one knew it would be so successful. You know, yeah. So it was a surprise to everyone, though. It deserved it. It was a good picture, you know. That was Bug's Life. And they're the best pictures I ever worked on, in terms of quality.
Yeah, really? Yeah. Randy, you don't mind people talking in the background?
Huh?
You don't mind people talking in the background?
When there is a take or something?
Yeah.
Yeah, I might.
Yeah, you see, I knew he would. You see, I'll be shutting up at that.
Okay,
obviously.
71, please.
For the new recording of You've Got a Friend in Me, Randy hired veteran crooner and 60s heartthrob, Robert Goulet.
He's doing that now. We just did a take. Now he's doing, oh, we forgot to do this, forgot to, all of this, we forgot, we had a good take, but we forgot to do those things.
So, is there a formula? You've said that sometimes you have a picture, sometimes you don't. When it's just a clean...
Always picture when you're scoring.
Okay, fine.
Yeah.
So...
You never write, you sometimes write when you, before you have it completely done, but you're always writing to picture, never to script, never to, someone tells me, just write something like this and that. It's never like that. It's always
what you see.
What you see and what you get on a cue sheet.
We're going to try and take everybody. All right, let's try this.
Okay.
One, two.
You got a friend in me. You got a friend in me. When the road looks rough ahead and you're miles and miles from your nice warm bed, you just remember what your old pal said. Son, you got a friend in me. Yeah, you got a friend in me.
There's no doubting Randy's pedigree, and in 1999 he made Oscar history by receiving 3 Academy Award nominations for 3 different films.
You got a friend in me. You get troubles, and I got them too. There isn't anything I wouldn't do for you. We stick together, we can see it through. 'Cause you got a friend in me. Yeah, you got a friend in me.
Was it all his idea to have Barbie backing singers?
Yes, I have to admit it was.
Well, it's to try to see them snap with their hands molded like that.
You see, they don't. They're the only ones who really can't bend at the elbow.
Oh, so they just do this all the time.
Oh, yeah.
You got a friend in me.
Like doing stuff. Yeah, it'll be fun.
Join in, Ash.
Oh.
He's far too cool.
You're gonna see it's our destiny. You got a friend in me.
Music plays a pivotal role in animation, and in Randy Newman, John Lasseter has found a long-term collaborator.
How important is the relationship between you and the director of the movie?
It's usually the relationship of a farmer to his mule, with the composer being the mule. But John is a good guy, you know. I mean, it's very hard for me to say that any director is a good guy, but anyone is, I can't say.
Some other folks might be a little bit smarter than I am, bigger and stronger.
He described himself as a mule. He said he's the mule to you.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, sometimes he's stubborn, and you gotta like, yeah, mule, yeah.
Grab the mule.
But he's a handsome mule.
And as the years go by, our friendship will never die. You're gonna see it's our destiny. Me. You got a friend in me. You got a friend in me.
Thank you and good night.
Back in San Fran, work continues day and night to ensure the film is delivered on time. Everybody's contribution is vital, as it's taken literally hundreds of people to make this movie.
Ah! It's Shirt!
I'm officially freaked out now.
What are we gonna
One do? Of the final touches is lighting. It's used to pull the look of the film together.
Zerg's the character behind us. He's a new character for this movie.
Mm-hmm.
He's a baddie.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, but his scene you've got here is... I mean, there's an amazing amount of detail going on.
Yeah, this one was a lot of fun to light. We had a great time doing the little fog beams behind him to make him look... We were kind of trying to tie into a scene in Empire Strikes Back when Darth Vader arrives.
Ah, fantastic.
And, you know, just timing the animation of all the light on the top of the elevator arriving and having this blue light coming down from top. It's nice. I like that shot.
Despite the worldwide success of the first Toy Story, critics complained that the animation of the humans wasn't lifelike. This was a particularly difficult challenge for the technical team to overcome.
Probably the biggest challenge on this film has been how to incorporate all of the technologies, the technology developments that have happened since Toy Story was finished, and in particular a lot of the developments that happened on A Bug's Life, bring them into our picture so that it's more visually rich and complex, compelling to people, and yet keep the sense of Toy Story. I think Al looks terrific in his own sick kind of way. The kind of animation they've been able to get, the expressiveness, the cloth, the folds, he feels much more real. And yet, in the same regard, he does feel like a Toy Story human.
You know, when you look at a toy animated, nobody really knows how a particular toy is going to act. You know, if a speak and spell starts walking around, nobody's ever really seen a speak and spell walk around. But humans, we do know what humans look like. And that's been a long time challenge, not only of us here at Pixar, but just in computer graphics in general. We tried doing humans in Toy Story, and I think we all kind of felt that we could do better. Mm-hmm. We didn't do any in Bug's Life because there weren't any in that story, but knowing that we wanted to do some humans in Toy Story 2, we really put all of our finest minds behind pulling off the humans, and they've really done some remarkable, remarkable work.
With production complete after 1,000 days' work, the film is finally ready to be rendered. Every pixel of every image is computed using Pixar's specially developed software. It can take anything from 1 to 20 hours to produce each image. But despite all this technical wizardry, the images are still transferred in glorious Technicolor onto film.
We sort of set our goals pretty high mm-hmm. in doing a sequel. So whether you know the original or not, you're going to love Toy Story 2, you know, because it is a great movie unto itself. It has some really deep emotions. It's got some tremendous humor, you know. But we pull a lot of things from the original, refer to it all the time.
Brilliant.
Sent these great characters off into the world a few years ago, and we really just wanted to do another story with them. And I think the allure of the computer graphics has worn off to some degree because people have seen it in our films and in other stuff being produced, and now people can just focus on what's really important to us, which is the, you know, the story and the characters.
The one thing that people will be surprised about Toy Story 2 is probably the emotion. It's incredibly emotional, and that's what it even gets to me whenever I watch it. There's one part when you learn about the past history of this one new character, and it breaks your heart.
Hey, what you doing way up here?
I thought I'd get one last look at the sun before I get packed away again.
Look, Jesse, I know you hate me for leaving, but I have to go back. I'm still Andy's toy. Well, if you knew him, you'd understand. You see, Andy's...
Let me guess. Andy's a real special kid, and to him you're his buddy, his best friend. And when Andy plays with you, it's like, even though you're not moving, you feel like you're alive, because that's how he sees you.
How did you know that?
Because Emily was just the same. She was my whole world.
We went through so many iterations. At one point, we really couldn't figure out if Jesse was even going to be in the film. And right now, she's so integral, and she's such a heartwarming and emotional character. So her introduction, this extreme high, and then later on being this kind of, when she tells her abandonment story, and it's so sentimental and so emotional. That kind of Jessie's character and her, you know, how she grows, to me is probably kind of my favorite theme throughout the movie. Okay.
When somebody loved me, everything was beautiful. Every hour spent together lives within my heart.
Is there a scene in it that will always be for you? That's Toy Story 2.
There's a couple of moments in the film, like, I think the audience is going to go, what the heck is this?
What?
Geronimo!
To infinity
and beyond!
Don't talk to any toy you don't know!
And then there's another great moment that's kind of similar right at the very end, where the audience is going to go, what is going on? What?
Excuse me, ladies. Does anyone know where we might find the owl of Al's Toy Barn?
I can help. I'm tour guide Barbie. Please keep your hands, arms, and accessories inside the car and no flash photography. Thank you.
I'm a marriage spot.
Then make room for the single fellas. Ah!
And then there's a really great moment right in the middle of the film that I think is just a really moving, emotional moment that's just going to reach into your chest and grab the heart right out of it.
This is for Woody when you find him.
All right, but I don't think it'll mean the same coming for me.
So, John, the movie's finished, and my voice is on it.
Can you believe it? Your voice is in it.
You know, 3 months ago, if anyone had said to me, Andy, you're going to be in Toy Story 2, I would never, ever, ever have believed them.
So, is Toy Story 2 better than the first? Well, yes. It has a strong storyline with the most believable characters, and it's got the word hit written all over it. But then again, I'm biased, of course, because I'm in it. In fact, that's me. Stand by for my line. Mm-hmm. That's me, baggage handler number one.
Hold it! There's a couple more bags coming to the terminal.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
There's a lot of ways you can say hold it. There's a couple more bags coming from the terminal. That if for us, that's 3 hours.
That's 3 hours right there. Hold on!
Couple more bags coming from the terminal.
Bags, and if you got a little speech, you got to do a speech problem.
Hold it! There's a couple more bags coming to the terminal.
Just in case you missed it. And they're only jealous, those two. Managed to do mine in one take.
So, guys, what did you think of my line in the movie?
Actually, I wanted to take my name off the film.
Seriously?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I think, you know, any animated film that has baggage handlers in it, you're in, baby.
I'll be there.
You're in.
I'm mad.
I wonder if there's an Oscar for best voiceover.
You think one little line, one stupid little line, out of thousands.
Yeah.
You know, that's all it is.
I never liked him anyway. He was a right old misery, that bloke on the left.
But you know, Toy Story 3.
Could
you know?
Start with baggage handler
number one. It really could.
See, that's the right idea.
You know, all joking aside.
Yeah, yeah.
I think you saved the movie.
I told you, Angela, without me, they would have been nothing.